revolution. Working fewer hours can make you richer.
Woo-hoo!
Woo! That. Yeah. Okay, so basically the speech is, the end of the talk is to show the audience of small business owners how working more hours in their business does not guarantee financial success. In fact, working fewer hours can make you richer, because having a smaller amount of time for your business creates a wonderful shift. It forces you to work differently, it makes you evaluate how you work in your business, and crucially, having limited time makes you reassess how you make money. It invites you to consider a different paradigm, a paradigm where you make limited, tiny time the opportunity, not the challenge. And when you embrace the challenge, it makes you richer, not only in your purse, but with your time. And couldn't most of us have time? They say that rich is having money, but wealth is having money and the time to spend it. So I think that's the key thing for both, or for all of us in this case. Now, Yasmin is the Tiny Time Big Results coach. She's an author and a speaker for small business owners who want a profitable business in less than 20 hours a week. I made a mistake once and thought it was 20 minutes. I totally signed up for that game. She re-explained, I misunderstood that, it was 20 hours, I had to think about it. A former vice president of leadership development, Yasmin specializes in business and marketing strategy and runs her thriving business from her home in Ireland around her three young children. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give it up for Yasmin Vorajee.
These are the things that I believe make a rich life. And as Sean was saying, that being rich is not just about the money in your bank, but it's about the time that you have. It's about the experiences that you have. It's about the quality of life that you have. And so today I want to share with you 5 guiding principles that will help you to create this profitable 20-hour week business. Because like I said, this is a journey. And that journey has taken me on a long way. Lots of ups and downs, lots of detours, and a few dead ends. And the way that I position these guiding principles are the 5 dead ends that I want you to avoid. If you can avoid these, then I promise you, your journey to that profitable 20-hour week business will be so much easier. So, let me share with you these 5 dead ends. So my eldest is 8, and he wants to be an inventor when he grows up. He was inspired by Tony Stark. Let me know who Tony Stark is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Iron Man, exactly. Yeah. I don't know what inspired him to want to be the billionaire Tony Stark who gets to play with toys. And so he comes to me and he says, Mom, I've got a great idea for an invention. Okay, great, tell me what it is. I said, it's going to be a robot, and it's going to have these big arms, and it's going to do all of these amazing things, and it's going to help me to get ready in the morning, and it's going to do my homework for me. Yeah. Great, okay. And his inventions are always quite big, you know, talking about going into space, which I think is great. But what I see when he's coming up with inventions is a common mistake that I see a lot of business owners making, because they get so excited and enthusiastic about what it is that they do, and it's the big vision, but they find it hard to translate that to their audience. So when I look at my 8-year-old and I say to him, Fionn, that's a great idea. Here's what I want you to tell me. And this is what I say to business owners. What's the problem you're solving? What is the problem that you are solving when you are coming up with this invention? Because invention is the mother of necessity. So it's when something really needs focus, that's when we look for that solution. If you think about your ideal clients, what are they typing into Google to find? So what is the problem that you're solving? And this was a big dead end for me, because I was exactly like what my 8-year-old does, full of ideas, and I was talking about structuring businesses and things like that. And the problem was, it just kind of went over people's heads, and I couldn't make it tangible enough. So if you can make your marketing message, what you do, tangible and specific and relevant, then I promise you, that's already your solid foundation. The second dead end is all about disconnection. So my 2-year-old, little boy, who has recently discovered the word no, and likes to use it a lot, he's a great eater. Very, very thankful, he's a great eater. But every once in a while, he gets a bit generous, and he starts eating the wall, or the floor. There have been times when I found a bit of pasta stuck to the wall, or a lump of potato behind the sofa. And I think, you know what, Dara? It's great that you're feeding the wall and the floor, but really that food needs to go to your tummy. And what that makes me think of is the way that a lot of business owners do their marketing. It's a bit like throwing spaghetti on the wall and hoping it sticks. Now, some of it does, but most of it ends up and it's a congealed mess. And what that means is people then say, I'm doing loads of marketing, I'm on social media all the time, and nothing's happening, I've got no clients. The problem is, it's because your marketing is not connected. It's not well thought through. You haven't created an ecosystem around your marketing that tells you, this is my offer, and this is what I'm gonna be creating from a marketing perspective. When it's disconnected, people can't see the steps that they're gonna take from how they get to find out more about you to becoming a paying client. So that's your second strategy that you need to think about, is how do you connect your marketing together so that it makes sense and it makes it easy for your prospects to become paying clients. The third dead end makes me think about my dad. But in a good way, because I love my dad. My dad, when we were little, he used to make us go around car showrooms. He loves looking at cars. And funnily enough, he still does that, but now he takes my kids with him. And when we were kids, we used to get really antsy as soon as we could see a car salesman coming towards us. You know the spiel. Oh, you're looking for a car, and suddenly, you know, you feel like you're being twisted into buying something that you actually don't want. And that always put this bad taste in my mouth, if you like, around sales and selling, because I thought it was pushy. I thought it was me forcing myself onto someone and saying, buy my stuff. And actually, sales is an amazing thing because it brings money into your business. But if you shy away from sales and the selling conversation, then you're leaving so much money on the table. And so it's about embracing sales and having a proven way to convert your prospects into paying clients. When you embrace sales, and the way I like to look at it is when you fall in love with what sales can do for you, things change. And I was that person where I was sitting there going, no, I don't want to ask someone, you know, to pay me for what I have. When I got over myself and said, listen, your kid needs shoes, or we have to pay the electricity bill, I got over myself pretty quickly. And it's something that I think that doesn't have to be a painful exercise. It can be something that you embrace and you walk towards it lovingly. The fourth dead end is around how you make money. And as Sean said earlier, a tiny time business really focuses you to think differently about how you make money in your business. So when I met Mary, she's one of my clients. She's one of my most favorite clients. Probably shouldn't say that, but anyway, it's like saying you've got a favorite child. but she's based in Belfast. And when I first met Mary back in 2014, she was making handmade knickers and bras, and she was selling them for £50. That was a lot of work. And through our work together, she realized that she wasn't gonna be able to make the money that she wanted by using this business model. What we actually did was, the reason why she wasn't gonna be able to make the money is because she was exchanging her time, and what I wanted her to do was to create an incredibly valuable product. So what we did was we shifted her mindset. And what we did was we actually created a premium product. Now, I say we, she did the work. And what she did was she actually transitioned into creating bespoke wedding shapewear. So if you think of Spanx, but for a wedding dress. If you think of some of those wedding dresses that have got really plunging backs or really complicated necklines, she's an engineer by profession. So she was actually able to mix her engineering skills and her sewing skills and create this amazing product. She went from charging £50, she now charges £750 for a piece. 15 times how much she was charging at the beginning, and it's the same amount of work. So this is a dead end. If you have time-thirsty products, programs, and services, if you're selling your time, then tiny time is going to be a really tough reality for you. So the way to get around that is by having a business model that allows you to exchange your value, not time. And the final dead end that I want to share with you today, which I think probably every single one of us can relate to this, it's time slippage, that's what I call it. Have you found that when you go onto your laptop and you start scrolling on Facebook, the next thing you know you think, oh God, 15 minutes has gone by, an hour has gone by, or an idea pops into your head and you start Googling? How many of you can relate to that? Ah, come on, you've got to be a little more. Yeah. We're all a little bit guilty of that. The reality is, I work in my business from 9 till 12 every day. When my kids are at school and crash. And when I know I've only got 3 hours a day, Facebook scrolling is really not an option. I still do it. But it's not a good use of my time. And what I discovered was, when I was working in corporate, I worked in corporate for 12 years, if I had a half-day holiday, I was amazed how much I actually got done in the morning. If I had the afternoon off, I got so much done in that space of time. And that really got me thinking, okay, but if you only give yourself 3 hours, how much could you achieve? And I don't stand in here in front of you as if I'm some guru. I really am not. I think of myself as an adventurer. Bit of a, you know, I'm an adventurer, because I want to just see, can this work? Is this possible? So now I can do my client work, I can do my marketing, I can do the admin. But I can do it in 3 hours a day. I might get an hour later if I'm lucky. Sometimes, maybe sometimes doesn't like to have his nap, but that's okay. But with three kids under eight, I have to be really focused with my time. And I know that when business owners come to me and they say, can you help me with my time management is actually the last piece that I look at. Because if you focus on your business model and what you are doing, then actually that will help you to rectify a lot of your time management issues. Now the two things, or three things, that you will, I suppose, need to focus on is first of all focus, because that's just sitting down and doing the work. Conquering procrastination. We're all a good procrastinator in here. I'll do it later. And this distractions. So conquering your procrastination and banishing your distractions is absolutely crucial in your business. A really helpful little tip that I learned was to get rid of the news, Facebook newsfeed by using a Chrome extension. That saves me so much time. Little things like that can make a huge difference. And that is my philosophy when it comes to tiny time, big results. And this journey, these dead ends, and knowing how to avoid these dead ends, leads me to standing here in front of you. As a published author, I wrote and published and marketed that book in 5 months, and I worked 3 to 4 hours a day. I got that to number one bestseller. And I don't say that because I'm bigging myself up. Maybe I'm a little bit. But I think it's important to see what is possible. And that for me is really what is key when it comes to talking about tiny time revolution. Because it's not about just the money in your back pocket. It's about the time that you spend. It's about the fulfillment that you experience in life. And being open to the possibility that maybe, just maybe, working fewer hours could actually make me a lot richer. The question is, are you ready to make that shift? I'll leave that with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Yasmin. Great job. Well done. Well done indeed. Okay, if in your groups, please. Actually, before I send you to groups, just...